Blog Talk Radio.
Good evening, everybody. This is The Long Road to Ruin, and I am your host, the Mandated Reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified, Mr. Mark Radulich. Before we get into tonight's topic, I have some business I need to get out of the way right up front. One, I apologize to Shaun, Alexis, and everybody else who listened to our last couple of shows between Long Road to Ruin and Metal Hammer of Doom, where my audio was inaudible as fuck, or as they say, inaudible as fuck. I apologize. I don't know if it could have been helped. May have been a microphone issue, may have been a Blog Talk issue, may have been a slow processing computer issue. I don't really know. I've gone about the getting a headset and microphone, and the test I ran on it worked. So far, our pre-show conversation, there was no echo. There was no inaudible mark sound, which if there is one now, I'm going to feel sheepish. But so far, so good. So again, I apologize. I take this stuff seriously, believe it or not. And I'm sure some of you are like, dude, you're fucking clown shoes. What do you mean you take this seriously? Well, I mean, look, I have a sense of humor, but I do try to take the production on this stuff seriously. I run the Radulich and Brog Talk Radio like a business, believe it or not. And when I have bad production problems, like inaudible sound, if it's frustrating for you, it's maddening for me. And I take pride in what we do here, believe it or not. So I felt bad about it. I spent the money. I think I fixed it. Hopefully I fixed it. And going forward with any show that we do, hopefully that won't be a problem again. And if it is, I don't know what to do. The second thing I need to get out of the way is apologies to Gavin Napier and anyone else who was looking forward to him and me talking about the Paul Thomas Anderson movies. Just ran out of time. My wife was in a car accident last week. She's fine. She's fine. She was not injured. It was a fender bender. But it caused havoc with the schedule, and, you know, something's got to get cut. So we cut the show. We're going to reschedule it for a later date. We're going to talk. Gavin and I will talk. There Will Be Blood and The Master, because God knows I watched half of that movie and have lots of questions. Mostly, why does anyone like this movie? So I owe that to Gavin. I owe that much to him. We'll get it done. I just got to get it rescheduled, probably sometime in early 2017, after the holidays. Excuse me. And lastly, and after I make this announcement, I'm going to bring on my co-host. This is it. This is it. This is the last Long Road to Ruin. We did not know this would be the last show when we planned it. And I have to give a quick shout out to Mr. Rocco, superfan James Rocco, who has been asking us to do this Three Flavors Cornetto Trilogy for a while now. He's also been asking us to do commentaries on movies.
Film commentaries, yeah.
Yeah. We'll get there. It's just a matter of blocking out the time and figuring out how to do it. Still on the to-do list. But he had been asking for this, and so I wanted to. So if we were going to have a last show, I wanted it to be this one. And just as a way of saying thank you to him. And before the end of the show tonight, we'll do a full round of thank yous to all the people who've supported the show. But I wanted to thank him up front, especially. In any case, this is our last show, and that's not the last for me and Shaun. Shaun will be on our Assassin, Damn You Hollywood, reviewing Assassin's Creed, and then starting early January, we'll be doing a new show called On Trial. And therein lies the issue. Never mind some of the personal stuff that was going on, which I'm not going to get into, and there's no point anymore to talk about it. But personal stuff aside, between Shaun and I, we kind of came to the conclusion that this show had run its course. Yes, there are many, many other franchises yet to do. We never got around to The Godfather or the Indiana Jones movies, but I think we have done our bit for God and country, and it was time to try on something new. Shaun and I are both very motivated, creative people, and I think sometimes both of us run in separately and together, both of us run into the issue of not boredom as such, but wanting to try new challenges, wanting to do something different. You know, the show ran for a while, so I know for myself, I wanted to do something a little bit different. And so we came up with On Trial. I'm very excited about it. It was an idea that had been gestating since we looked at the X-Men movies earlier this year. And Shaun doesn't know this, but I've actually planned out most of next year's On Trial schedule.
Oh, I'm not surprised at all. Not in the least.
I'll eventually let him in on what we're doing, what I've decided we're doing. I left some dates open for you, though. I did leave some dates open for you. But yeah,
I thought we promised we were alternating the movies.
We are. That's what I mean by I left some dates open for you. Half the
year.
Oh,
okay. You mean you pick your movies?
Correct.
Okay. And we're still starting with Big Trouble in Little China, right?
Yeah, that hasn't changed.
Okay. Okay, good.
In any case, so that's that. That's all the business. Let's get into this, our very last Long Road to Ruin, and then when we're done talking about these movies, I'll say a few more words. So will Shaun, I'm sure. Speaking of Shaun, you heard him just now. Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, my co-host, Shaun Comer. How you doing, Shaun?
How do you do? I'm Shaun, you're not. And Flonase is made of anti-snot magic, I swear to God.
We're classy.
That stuff is straight up miraculous. I've been sick since this past weekend, so if you hear me coughing, that's why. But the good news is, when I got home Sunday night and right on into Monday morning, I could scarcely breathe through my nose. I don't know what happens at about 4,000 feet. And with all the allergies that was up there and all the allergens, all them allergies that are up there in that dar press get up in them mountains, but wreaked unholy havoc on me. So I'm going to sound a little bit off, but yeah, for starters, Mark is not kidding. All I have to do on these podcasts is just show up with my research, my notes, and just, for better and for worse, be myself. Mark is the one who messages me and tells me, okay, this is what I got laid out for the rest of the year. Let me know what you think. And half the time I've usually got like five other things going on at the same time. So I read it, I look for anything that stands out to me, and otherwise I just say, okay, that's cool, let's do it. And then generally about 5 minutes later, I'll have to ask him, when are we doing this again? I am sometimes the J to his Kevin Smith. Yeah.
You know, don't let it bug you. I have a lot of time at work to fuck with my calendar. So when I'm not chasing crazy people, all right, let's get into this. So I have a question for you, cause I know you've done the research. I assume you have.
Yeah, sure.
And it's this isn't one where I'm steeped in a lot of the lore. As a matter of fact, I mean, I've seen Shaun of the Dead before. I've seen Hot Fuzz before. I loved both movies, and I'm not a really zombie movie fan, to be honest with you. But I thought Shaun of the Dead was hilarious, and Hot Fuzz, probably one of my top 20 favorite movies. I think I love it. I could watch that on a loop. I've never seen The World's End before yesterday. Apparently, Alan Thicke has passed away.
Sorry
to bring the tenor of the show down, but you know, I feel like I had to acknowledge the beep that just occurred on my desk. Yeah, my wife just sent me a private message that said Alan Thicke had passed away. That's sad.
Oh, not Mr. Seaver.
Yeah. We'll always remember you, Mr. Seaver. All right,
best,
so here we go with
the
awkward segue.
With Mike.
And Ben.
I'm just strictly talking about Kirk Cameron being flaming pants on head manners.
Whatever happened to Ben? Did he turn out to be anything? Because I don't think he's done anything since Growing Pains.
Oh man, you know, I feel like there was some kind of E! True Hollywood Story thing that happened there, and I'm just not remembering. The only things that I remember about hearing about behind the scenes on Growing Pains were Kirk was already blossoming into a fine little bigoted religious nut job then. Tracy Gold, I will not make a joke about this because it's real close to home with me and a number of people that I love, was plagued by an eating disorder.
Oh, poor thing.
And I know. And again, I won't say anything about that one because ain't anything funny about that. I will not laugh about it. I will dress down anybody who tries to make a joke about it.
You don't have to tell me.
I
just learned tonight that some kid's calling my daughter fat in her classroom, so I had to deal with that tonight.
Oh,
so,
hell
yeah.
No. Lily?
Yeah.
She's what, how old?
She'll be 6 in January.
Oh, okay, yeah. If he were a few years older, I would say let that Brock Lesnar-looking son of yours loose on him.
I have a funny feeling when he gets of age that that's the sort of thing that will be happening on an ongoing
right.
basis. But
but as far as Ben goes, no, I mean it's nothing scandalous or anything, but I think I heard that the actor is gay. I think, or I could be thinking of the kid from Who's the Boss, or maybe both of them for all I know. But I mean, you know, that's, you know, nothing salacious or anything about it. Just likes guys. Good for him. But no, Alan Thicke. Oh man, okay. Canada is one less great man this evening. But anyway, getting back to your question. Impromptu eulogy. You had a question about the Cornetto trilogy.
Yes, I did. Okay, so I just watched The World's End last night for the very first time. It's not one that we initially interested in, but eventually I wanted to see it, and that's what made things really good for me, was I didn't realize that other than this being the same group of actors, that until Rocco had suggested it, that it was a trilogy of sorts, and I did a little bit of reading on it, but not much, like I said, not steeped in the lore. So here's my question, after a 20-minute build. Did Edgar Wright intend this to be a trilogy, or was it sort of after the fact?
I don't know that he really intended it to. It's a trilogy in a loose sense, in the same way that it's on this show because, yeah, I guess it's loosely a franchise in that. Yeah, it's themed after the flavors of Cornetto ice cream, but really it's a connected continuous franchise in about the same way the first three volumes of Kevin Smith's Jersey anthology are, which is to say barely at all. Shaun of the Dead in particular, since that's our starting point, there really is no real fascinating genesis about that, except for the fact that Edgar Wright and Simon Pegg both worked together on the BBC on the BBC's Spaced, along with Nick Frost, which is a superb show. And if the BBC hadn't gotten the biscuit up their bum and yanked it off Netflix, it would still be available there to watch now. A little bitter about that. But it was a real great comedy for kind of Gen X-ish nerds, kind of like you and myself, Mark. Kind of slacker geeks seeking direction, sort of. And from there sprang this idea to do as the marketing so succinctly put it, a rom-zom-com, a romantic zombie comedy. And, for a change, I'm not going to blow my wad with my opinions of it right out of the gate, but I'll just say that as far as this one goes, I generally have a very extreme either take it or leave it relationship with the zombie craze. It's everything is either a roaring hit with me, or it's bland, unremarkable, and I haven't the faintest of earthly clues what anybody sees in it. Hot Fuzz was actually based on a student film that Wright had made, which, judging from the Wikipedia entry, he described as Lethal Weapon in, I forget what the name of the village is now, Senfordshire Dumb, or I don't know. Sure enough, one
let's
of my first friends from FPG knew the Shire.
Yes, let's call it the Shire.
Yeah, he said it was that his movie was basically supposed to be Lethal Weapon in the Shire, and so what ultimately ended up happening was, like a lot of other films like Christopher Nolan's Following or James Wan with Saw, it ended up becoming a full-length feature of its own. It just kind of took off from that. And then I guess they decided, well, we did two, we kind of declared it a trilogy, guess it's time to close this out, and we ended up getting The World's End, which the funniest story about that is the fact that at the time, Simon Pegg at one point, I guess had a conversation with Seth Rogen, who was working on a very similarly titled movie. And it also revolved around a kind of madcap apocalyptic premise. And Seth asked Simon if he would mind retitling his movie, which, just putting it out there, I hold Seth Rogen in roughly about the same regard as James Franco, which is to say he has one character that he usually plays, and that character has been funny to me, I think, about twice. And in Seth's case, I believe that would be Superbad and Pineapple Express. I would throw 40-Year-Old Virgin in there, but honestly, I sometimes forget he was even in it, even though he had a major supporting role. But Simon politely told him, well, no, we can't really do that because our title actually refers to a central location that's key to the plot in our movie. And so Seth ended up titling his, I think it's This Is the End.
Correct.
Was what his movie was ultimately called, yeah. His piece of shit comedy was ultimately the one that had to bend and change all its branding, which rightfully so, because while I can't say I was overwhelmed by The World's End, it was, as one would expect when comparing anything Edgar Wright and Simon Pegg and Nick Frost do to anything that Seth Rogen does, the far and away superior movie. So that's really about it, though. Strangely, I never caught anything that actually said, "Oh yeah, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna lay this all out. We're going first. It's gonna be Shaun of the Dead, and then it's going to be Hot Fuzz, and then we're gonna end it all with The World's End." From what I can tell, they made Shaun of the Dead. It ended up being shockingly popular, more so than anybody anticipated. And from there, like it happens with breakout comedy teams like that, the first thing they wanted to know was, what else you got? Yeah. So...
Okay, very good. There are definitely some themes that run throughout all three movies, especially Shaun of the Dead and The World's End. Hot Fuzz, less so. Shaun of the Dead is clearly a romantic comedy set in a zombie film, but the whole thing, as near as I can tell, correct me if I'm wrong, is also a sort of a parody done right. A parody done the way Mel Brooks intended parodies to be, not the way the Wayans brothers intended them to be.
You're not wrong, but I think there's a better way to put it. The way they're all set up is, believe it or not, you know what I like in these three movies too, Mark? You're not going to believe this. The Marvel Cinematic Universe. No, seriously.
Go on.
Well, because the reason I say that is because what I love most about the Marvel movies is, and I'll never forget my good friend Cole Marantet pointing this out to me, and I gave it a moment's thought, and I went, "Hell, you're absolutely right." He said they use superheroes not necessarily as a genre in themselves, but a setting, as a backdrop,
right,
to tell a story against. And I've pointed out the same examples a number of times, but I'll go ahead and throw them out there again for our first, and by the way to join the party late, guys, listeners. And that is, for example, you have Avenger. That's very much an Indiana Jones-style historical action epic. Thor, I tend to view as very much a kind of almost high fantasy. Iron Man is a trilogy of tech thrillers. Captain America, The Winter Soldier, as opposed to the first Avenger, is a very taut political conspiracy thriller. Ant-Man is a heist comedy, so on and so forth. Guardians of the Galaxy is kind of a comedic space opera. Probably the closest our generation is ever going to get in theaters to Star Wars. But the Cornetto Trilogy kind of does the same thing in each of their three movies, slightly less so with Hot Fuzz, but with Shaun of the Dead, and I'll just kind of go through each of them as we get to them. With Shaun of the Dead, you have a zombie apocalypse as the backdrop to a very relatable story when you take the time to really connect to it. And that's the story of a man who's been sleepwalking through his life with very little ambition, nothing to look forward to. And all of a sudden, he looks around him one day and finds himself a man apart and not really sure entirely how to survive, because one by one, he's losing out on the survivors who are even remotely like him, until he's got no one but himself, his best friend, and his long-suffering, impatient girlfriend pull him through. And that's one of the things about the zombie genre that really tends to bother me, and that's the fact that zombies have been used as a heavy, ham-fisted punch square on the nose of allegory so many times that it's just almost obnoxious by this point how obvious it becomes. Going clear back to George A. Romero's Night of the Living Dead, they were an allegory for racism and fear and prejudice. With Dawn of the Dead, he not so subtly used them to, I guess, kind of take some of the piss out of rampant consumerism. With the last one that he did, the really shitty one that's centered on a big luxury tower, Land of the Dead, that's it. You got elements of segregated classism, and other movies have tried to do the same shit, but like you said before, it's an attempt to do a parody, but it's a parody with heart. And when American movies try to do parody, you know, it is very much the American way. We cannot wait to flop out our big red, white, and blue dick and wave it in your face and show you how proud we are of it. When we do a parody, we absolutely think it's the most brilliant goddamn thing ever made. So much so that we can't wait to enthusiastically explain the brilliance behind every single joke we're putting up on screen. We can't wait to show you how many things we can reference in 90 minutes to 2 hours. Because, oh my God, it is going to be an orgasm of satire. Only it isn't.
Sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, Edgar Wright and Simon Pegg, in particular, when they decide to satirize something, oh yeah, there's references aplenty. I mean, Hot Fuzz, which we'll talk about in a few minutes, contains references both kind of in terms of incidental clips playing in the background, DVD covers, and just little winking homages to more than 100 different action movies. But it's something that's really done in a very sly manner. Well, and in Hot Fuzz's case, especially since, as both Simon and Edgar noted, England doesn't really have any quintessential action cop movies. So it's sort of them kind of having a little fun with it from the outside looking in on something that isn't really theirs. So, but yeah, it's that kind of smart subtlety about it, that they tend to kind of give the audience a little more credit that they'll get the joke and don't need it kind of crammed down their craw.
It's funny you mentioned the difference between like American comedies and somebody. I was talking to my friend about this earlier. I said, we were talking about, and I don't want to get sidetracked into a long discussion about this because once was enough this past summer, but I needed it to make a point.
We were
talking about Ghostbusters this year, and you know, it was a part of a larger discussion, but I said, you know, I was using that as an example of, you know, he was saying to me, like, you know, I saw that trailer for Ghostbusters and it just looked like crap. And it didn't matter. No stuff really matter. I just wasn't interested in that movie. And I said, you know, but here's the thing. The trailer for Ghostbusters, that was no different than any of the American comedy trailers you see these days. Occasionally you have a jet come out. For the most part, why Robert and I don't review them on Damn You Hollywood is it's gag, set up, gag. Everybody acts like clowns that, you know, aren't even remotely relatable in any real life situation. Mm-hmm. And the trailers are cut that way. So the example I was giving in comparison were, you know, if you look at Why Him, the Bryan Cranston movie with James Franco, where his daughter is meeting the Facebook guy and he's a weirdo, and Office Christmas Party, those two big comedies that are out right now, they're both cut the same way, and they look like garbage. And if you would, the example I used was, if instead of Ghostbusters, they had decided they were going to call the movie Ghost Bitches and had no association with the original movie at all. It was a new, brand new thing and cut the same exact trailer. It wouldn't have garnered even half. It would have looked like your typical American shit comedy. But it had a franchise attached to it and sacred some. And people got, now I'm bringing up people who legitimately look at this shit other way to look at. That's all they're saying. But there were definitely people who would have just fine. They could call any Ghostbusters based on the fact that you meeting a lot of American comics and thinking this is people don't like them. They do well, make money. You have the occasional one, like I said. I think the last Amy Schumer comic came out that I just seen it. It was actually very well written. That wasn't set gag. It was, you know, the comedy was inherent in the way the characters were interacting, and it wasn't just try to shove as many laughs in a 5-minute period as you can. And that's to link this back to Shaun of the Dead. That was my favorite, was instead of putting the comedy down in your throat the way modern American comedy does, you know, your Will Smith comedies for the most part, the laughs were very natural. There was a lot of subdued, sort of like straight lines being delivered, but they were delivered in interesting scenarios. So every time a cat got read off, which is not like, you know, it's not as crazy in the movie. You know, it's a line that's being delivered of about a very obvious thing, but it's terrible to me. Just in the middle of chaos, in the middle of this nonsense that's going on, noticing he has red on his shirt.
Mm.
That's to me. And that's a small example of things. I mean, some are a little set up gag, you know, him defending the Nick Frost character. And as soon as he's done defending him, Nick Frost blows any cunt on a fight. A little gaggy, a little setup, a little gaggy. But it's okay to do that in small doses. One is in your comedies, to have, like I said, the laughs come naturally over the course of the plot being developed and the characters being developed and not just set up on.
Hey, Mark.
Yeah.
I got good news and I got bad news.
Okay.
The good news is the Echo, merciful Jesus roasting on a stick over an open fire is gone. I have not heard it once. It has not thrown me off. The bad news is I struggle to maintain most of everything you said, although I agree with everything that I could pick up because the call has been warbling in and out for the last several minutes, and I've been waiting for it to get better. Let me ask you something. Is my reception coming through okay?
You're fine. Occasionally you get a little fish bully, but for the most part, you
Yeah, see, I'm gonna duck out real quick and try to rejoin the call in just a second because I don't know what the deal is. This only seems to happen when I'm doing calls with blog talk, and it was fine when we were doing the pre-show. It was fine during the first part of the show, but now all of a sudden, it's going all wonky, and I have no idea what's going on. So. One last time, live, everybody. All right, I'm going to call back in just a second. I'll be right back.
Okay. While Shaun takes a quick break and dials back in, let me do a very, very quick plot synopsis of this thing, as we do, just in case you haven't seen these movies. So in 50 words or less, I'm not going to go beat by beat by beat, but basically, as Shaun is pointing out, you have... On one hand, a situation where you have a character, Simon, as you will, who is sort of down on his luck. He's as Shaun, he is sleepwalking life. He lives with one roommate, and then the Nick Frost character has sort of just been sleeping on the couch and the guest that won't leave. The movie begins with his relationship in turmoil. And
by the way, this is much better. I don't know what happened there, but
may just be a thing. Just when it starts to get wonky, one of us has to dial back in. Happens with Jesse all the time. In any case,
that helps.
I also try to be a little bit more still. I don't know if that's affecting things at all, but it might me moving around a lot might also be messing with the mic. In any case,
I think I might have just figured out what it might be. I am outside right now. But I think maybe it might be picking up ambient noise or something when I don't have the call muted while you're talking. So what I'm going to do is, God knows I shouldn't have to, going to mute the call so you're not picking up anything from my end while you're talking and see if maybe that helps. I am throwing science at the wall and seeing what sticks here. So go right ahead. I'm going to hit mute and just keep talking.
Okay. So what we hear at the beginning is Shaun's relationship in turmoil with his girlfriend. It's a tale as old as time. The girl is expecting more from the guy is not quite ready to give more, doesn't want the relationship to end, but is just sort of, she ends up breaking up with him. We have another character who's her best friend, who's secretly in love with her, but it's her girlfriend, which we'll learn about over the course of the movie. And that takes us to kind of the first beat of Shaun of the Dead. Departure, slight move away from this comedy, guy in the midst of trying to figure out his life and figure out how to win his girlfriend to deal with zombies. And again, this is where such a big difference between American and British comedy, for the most part, humor, is you have these zombies that show up at the character's home, and they don't realize what it is they're doing. They think they're dealing with drugs. Then the woman falls on a pole and it impales her, and they realize, well, she's also not dead. quite a lot. They don't quite know what to make of it. And then they just start to deal with problems with the tools they have at hand. And of course, very adequately, but you know, they make do. And it's built. You know, they start with like this rotten stuff at them. And that's a, and I'll tell you, again, one of the funniest bits of is in the subtleties, like getting a pile of records together. Now, as somebody who hosted some record review show, you know, metal specifically, the Metal Hammer Room Wednesdays at 9 o'clock on the Radulich and Broadcasting Network. As somebody who is a huge fan of music, I absolutely see myself, you know, need to throw record zombies, throw that one, not that one, not that one, not that one, not that one, that one's fine. And some of the choices they picked were really funny to me. And then just getting fed up with the whole thing, going into the shed and grabbing what looked to be like a cricket bat and a shovel. And the movie just sort of goes on from there. As far as directing and style, there's a lot of cuts, a lot of close-ups, a lot of repetition. This is something that will happen in Hot Fuzz and The World's End. It very much is an Edgar Wright thing. They realize that the zombies have sort of overtaken. You got to make sure that the girlfriend is safe, that mom is safe. They got to find a place and wait for this whole thing. And kind of, that's the thread that takes us to the major thing once all the terms. And which is sort of the last stand for this group. A couple of different scenarios to deal with. This power, but the power then through collapse. These people be street, and then they're saved by bus. They are the last two remaining. Not on the game shows. Dealing with the romantic comedy tropes, the relationship tropes, and the zombie tropes is the magic that makes this movie work so well. I say that as somebody who's not. I've watched a few of them. They're okay. They're strong. One of those that are fired. And in movies, the heart of a good movie. Identify the later characters to each other, the room can kind of revolve. And that was, I think, the big and a major source of my enjoyment. More I'm feeling, you know, one more system. Still on mute.
Can you hear me?
There you go. Okay. Can hear you.
I think I figured out what the problem is. I don't think it's you're using Skype, right?
I figured out the mic issue.
The headset solved the echo issue. Unfortunately, nothing can solve, because I recognize it now. This is this exact same thing happened the other day when I was talking to my friend Scarlett on Skype, and in fact, our call dropped twice. Fucking hell.
Let me try connecting the direct. Let me try disconnecting the direct connect.
What I said. Give it a shot.
I'm going to throw it to you to give your impression of the film and things that stood out to you. So, do your thing. Let me back in.
Okay. I guess I'll just go ahead. I had everything kind of organized into a back and forth between Mark and I, but I guess now I'll just let fly with my thoughts. One of the things that stands out to me most is the fact that I like that this the way that Shaun and Ed react to everything is very much to me the way that someone like me and a number of my friends would probably react to this same scenario in a lot of instances. Folks, we are not going to be fucking Leon S. Kennedy. Okay, most of us. We are not going to be able to probably patch a tin bucket and drills together into a weapon. We're not going to be running around shopping malls, plunging nails into MMA gloves to basically make a set of gauntlets. No, a lot of this is that really weird mix of confusion, horror, bemusement, just grabbing whatever you can and just flailing and fighting around however you have to in order to survive. We aren't going to be sticking hidden gems we found into family crests so that we can turn a hidden section of wall around and find a key that we got to combine the two other keys that we got to fight sharks and snakes and plant monsters and giant spiders to get to so that we can go downstairs and we can open the ancient coffin and get the rocket launcher. That ain't the way it's going to work. We will grab cricket bats. If someone happens to be a vinyl collector, sure as shooting, somebody, the instant you grab a record to fling at somebody, is going to piss and moan because it's their limited edition White Stripes LP that they picked up last record store day. So that's the way you're going to react. I mean, we are not Arnold Schwarzeneggers. Sylvester Stallones. We're not Wesley Snipes. Fuck, on our best days, most of us are barely Reb fucking Brown. These are just two ordinary guys who, to paraphrase, and I apologize in all sincerity to Kurt Russell for butchering this, reasonable men who have just seen some very unreasonable things. And that is what makes it relatable, is it's insanity. But you could buy somebody dealing with it like that. And even prior to there being no more room in hell in the dead walking the earth, everybody in this movie, there's a little thread of them that you can kind of grasp onto, and the material just feels familiar. Well, Ed, for example, we all, especially at mine and Mark's age, we have at least, excuse me, one or two of those friends. Those ones where everybody else keeps trying to point out to us, they're just a little bit behind the curve. Hell, I had one of those going clear back to high school until a few years ago. In fact, my dad pointed it out to me a number of times until I finally just couldn't ignore it anymore. But, you love him anyway. you'll go right along with it. You can't really argue with it, but still, you just can't put a price on their loyalty. A lot of people have kind of been that overly patient significant other who just doesn't know when to throw in the towel until finally it's just one bridge too far, one toke over the line, and it just, you don't know quite exactly where your breaking point is, but you know it when you hit it. And in this case, it was just one time to...
One thing I wanted to...
Go ahead, Mark.
No, I was letting you finish.
Yeah, I know. I was trying to tell you, go ahead.
Hello?
I'm here.
Okay.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Yeah, one thing I wanted to point out was... what is that? Another thing that came very natural from the movie, and you started off, was how, you know, yes, these are ordinary guys put in extraordinary circumstances, which is, you know, usually a recipe for a pretty good film, and doing it in the best way they know how, just sort of things out of their ass, or the shed as it may be. But interesting things I found of the film where Shaun is somewhat rising to the challenge, and he's coming up with ideas, and you know, everything that the girlfriend wanted in him is starting to bubble out of him, and it's coming very naturally. He's going on instinct, but his instincts are sort of guiding them in what would appear to be the right direction. And then just as quickly as you start to see these sort of personal triumphs and him getting this sort of air of confidence part. and he even says in the movie, he's like, I failed anybody. And you know, and I think the line is something along the lines of, look, the what could you possibly do in these terrible circumstances? You at least had an idea. You tried to lead, and that's all I've ever asked of you. And I thought that was important. Because again, a lot of movies go too far in that direction. Where?
No, I was gonna say. Even that is really believable in terms of, and I speak from personal experience as somebody who a couple times has, to varying degrees, had to have been kind of jarred out of a malaise or a really unfortunate contentment, whether it was by a sudden realization, some sea change that turned out to be more pivotal than I expected, or as was the case 6 years ago, one person came into my life when I couldn't have expected her less, that as I told her the other night, she kicked down the door to my quiet, tepid little room and absolutely just kind of set fire to everything that was holding out the sun, and showed me everything that I had been missing. And it was then that I kind of had to begin a process of kind of rising to the occasion and kind of forcing myself to test my own limits and be more than I had allowed myself to believe I could be. And a lot of people go through that. Sometimes it's the loss of a loved one. Sometimes it's the loss of a job. Sometimes it's an unexpected opportunity. It could be anything. It could even be an utter catastrophe such as this, when there's no one else to lead except you. And it's one of those things. Well, another example of a zombie franchise that I can't invest myself in the show anyway. I love the source material and I love the Telltale video games, but The Walking Dead lacks emotion among a lot of these characters that I can sincerely relate to, at least in terms of the way it's expressed. That moment, the one you just mentioned, when Shaun says, "I couldn't save anybody," and she reassures him that there was absolutely nothing else he could have done, and that she loves him just simply for the fact that he stood up and gave it his all and decided to commit himself to it. I mean, that is something truly believable. Not just everybody sort of walking around sporting the same grimy scowls, and Norman Reedus always looks like he just smelled a wet fart, and Rick Grimes looks progressively more and more like a lost member of the Wyatt family. And, you know, you have these characters that all just sort of run together. And as we'll also see to other degrees in the next two movies, it carries across the idea that in these situations, you're dealing with different people who process in different ways. And I mean, and now I want to go back a little bit because you, before I, unfortunately, I apologize for that, cut you off. You started to say that in a different way, other movies kind of tend to swing too far in one direction.
Yeah, they either swing too far in the suddenly the schlub, you know, this loser sleepwalking through life can do everything right, you know, and is this, and becomes, you know, like John McClane, you know, or Rambo. They just suddenly they, and it was like, where was, and the only thing that's a challenge at this point is, you know, is when they finally get to like a villain sequence of some sort. You know, there's a bigger thing, a boss of some sort they have to deal with. Ridiculous. It's the kind of stuff that Winfrey and I have talked about with some of the movies this year, where it's like kind of a character. And yes, I understand arcs and personal growth, but this is too far. Or they go in the other direction, way too far, which is no matter what this person. Like, Shaun is a balanced character. And, you know, his inner lion, and he leads this group, is playing things by ear. Some successes, there are some errors. There's a sense of pride. There's feelings of guilt. Movie, it's actually very, very complex. Three-dimensional characters that if you move it to one side or the other could easily be very unbalanced and very unbelievable. But I think that's the beauty of these three movies, is as absurd as they can be at times, the characters themselves are very, very human, and as I said before, very relatable. I think we need last words on Shaun of the Dead, Hot Fuzz, since we've been at this for an hour. So I'll go ahead and throw it back to you. Anything left unsaid?
Well, just one thing, and that is that there's something that, and it's altogether possible that I'm reading a little bit too much into it and perhaps seeing what I want to see. So just kind of indulge my synesthesia for a moment. But there's something that's really poetic about the way that the movie ends, and that is the fact that Shaun goes from a man who is coasting, who is just taking it easy, staying the course, just sort of, I guess one could, if they want to be sanctimonious, perhaps say wallowing in his own contentment. And at the end, you see that he and his girlfriend have moved in together. He's more stable. He's happy. He's adulting. But, you know, he's still got Ed out in the shed that he can always make time to go play video games with. And there's something about that that really speaks to me, especially having just turned 34 and really not feeling that whole lament about my mid-30s and having sort of an adult checklist that I've got to tick off like I'm some completionist who's racking up Xbox achievements or PlayStation trophies. But, you know, it's the idea that you realize that there is a place still for that carefree and easygoing side of you, just that you have to kind of know where it is so that you know when you can make time to embrace it, but so that you can also look ahead and bask in everything and all the possibilities that are in front of you and all the new horizons and chances to grow. And when you can do that, it makes it all that much more special when you can just sort of, you know, tiptoe off out back and pick out the DualShock and just play a round or two of Tekken for a little while and just decompress for a bit. It's kind of who I am as a geek. It's so that's very easy to understand, and I don't know if that was their intent, but I commend them for something that I never really realized it kind of quite how poignant it was until I really settled in and watched it this time and kind of did so with open eyes, perhaps just given my age. So, and then we get this completely different, much less personal, but I would dare say easily every bit as much fun movie in Hot Fuzz.
Yeah, of the three, this is my personal favorite. And that's partially, I think, due to it's definitely more pure send-up than either The World's End or Shaun of the Dead. Like I said, it's this one less relationship based and more a send-up of a genre than the other two. I mean, there's some relationship stuff going on, but you could definitely see them having fun with more or so, the most so in Hot Fuzz than the other two movies. Number one. Number two, the young up, the buddy action comedy, a personal favorite, the buddy action film. A bunch on this show. I'm a big action person. You know, listen to me on this show or on Damn You Hollywood. I've talked a great deal about my love for action movies, disaster movies, comic book movies. It draws me to the theater more so than any other of genres. I love them. And when I saw Hot Fuzz the first time in the theaters, I laughed my ass off because I could recognize a lot of the ending up, a lot of the jokes they were making at the expense of the genre itself were very, very funny to me, you know, in this movie than in either of the other two. Not only that, I thought the idea itself appreciate it more. personal thing. I don't know if there's an idea of suddenly you wake up and your home has been overtaken by zombies, or in the other case, you go back home again, only to find out half your town has been replaced by robots. Blank.
You know, that actually,
or not
that
bots, whatever the hell they call them.
That actually brings to mind a question I'd like to ask you, though. Do you think that it feels a little bit different in part because American, in a way, American action buddy cop movies are really kind of a product of our culture, and there are a lot of aspects to that really just kind of don't translate over to British culture?
I would say, if I get the meaning of your question, three movies, this one, Hot Fuzz, was the most American. Are very British. And The World's End is the most British. About kind of doing an office thing with any one of these, you know, in terms of, well, here's the British version, now give me an American version of the very same movie. Okay, Shaun of the Dead, you could take the same premise and put it just about anywhere in America and have result.
Mm-hmm.
Hot Fuzz, in England at all. You could have done that and been the jokes about guns, basically. It's more funny. To me, it was more funny the idea of suddenly he shows up in town on a white horse that he pulled out of the evidence closet. There couldn't have been a more American image. I think my daughter came home as I was watching the end of Hot Fuzz from school, and she was like, why? Like, well, the sheriff has come back to reclaim the town, Lily. That's what's going on here. And that's what that's an homage to. You know, but like I said, this idea of one man versus an entire town full of guns, that's a American idea. And then, like, the world then, you know, the idea of the one guy that never grew up, once he got out, you know, who peaked in high school, getting his friend to come back around the route from one last route, that in America too. But I felt like it was funnier because it took place in England. And I guess that's subjective. You know, your mileage may vary. On that, but of them all most translatable to an American audience. I mean, you could not get what Hot Fuzz was about as an American movie killer. I think I answered your question.
Well, a little bit, because I mean, the way I see it is the way it kind of breaks down is it starts with Angel. His whole thing is he's basically being shuffled off against his will from London because he's too good at his job. It's a very quirky take on the more American action movie trope, the one we've made fun of so many times. Damn it, McBain, you're a loose cannon, but you get the job done. You know, the guy who's not too good. Yeah, the guy who's not too good at his so much. You know, too good at his job that he's making everyone look bad. It's the fact that they want to get rid of, you know, McBain or Axel Foley or Harry Callahan because they look on them as being fucking liabilities. And obviously, England not having quite the lawless gun culture that America has, and I don't think having quite the same cultures of crime from what I've been made to understand. Just the criminal world there is just so different. I think that's the other reason why it's so interesting, is because I don't think you could take a lot of American buddy cop movies and necessarily set them over there, because I think a lot of a lot of English people who would watch that would be thinking to themselves, the fuck is this shit? Nothing is like that over here. Who talks like that? Who acts like
right.
that? Whereas it's just that, it's just kind of that much funnier to see their own just very, very slight, clever skewing of those same tropes and those same conventions, and how it just seems like so much more of a very British kind of crime, that instead of it being a rampant drug lord or a human smuggling ring, it's a town that's killing off all its undesirables because they don't want to lose out on being named a village of the year. You want to talk about something that would never exactly translate in an ironic way over here. That's just perfect. So in the same way that something like Die Hard or Dirty Harry or Lethal Weapon is a movie that you could only set here in the United States, Hot Fuzz it wouldn't be as effective if you set it on like 8 Mile Road Detroit or right in the heart of Compton. It just wouldn't work. So it really is just kind of everything right in the right place. Well, right down to the fact that even the title, believe it or not, it is purposely nonsensical. I forget whether it was Peg or Wright, but one of them noted in an interview, they said, yeah, we just want to come up with the most ridiculous title that made no sense. I think they described the process of naming action movies in the U.S. as there's a hatful of nouns and there's a hatful of adjectives, and they just pick two and go with it. And it didn't matter if it made any sense with the movie. That was how you get titles like Point Break and Executive Decision. So, hence they just kind of went.
One of the great super cop movies of all times, Super Fuzz. Remember that?
I don't remember Super Fuzz, but I remember the movie Super Cop.
Fuzz. It was a cop. Very, very, very early 80s. I don't know if you can even find this on like digital video or anything anymore. But I remember when I was a kid, it was actually, I actually remember this very, very distinctly. Like, he had these superpowers and they wouldn't work if he was looking at yellow. Anywho. So one of the great things about Hot Fuzz, I mean, you were talking about the very un-American thing, a very British thing, that this town would kill undesirables for no other reason than trying to maintain the beauty and the aesthetic of their little village, their quiet, sleepy little village. Because you have the chief, whose wife, she killed herself because of the way the town was going, and sort of drove him to want to take these extreme measures to lose that aesthetic again. But he's really driven by something personal, with the loss of his wife. Everybody else in the town may have sort of a surface, you know, hey, we just don't want to lose our prestige motivation. The contrast of that with the initial assertion that it was a land grab. They originally go to arrest the Timothy Dalton character, and they go through this whole rigmarole of him explaining that there's happening at land, and it's like, no, it's not even close. But no, we just didn't want to not look pretty. That was great, because again, all the time, there's only so many ways you can tell these kinds of stories, and by very, very familiar, turning it on its head, doing something almost absurd, but coming up with some really fun motivations to get to the absurd was an interesting take on a very, I'd say tired, but on a very used genre. And then of that, you know, you were talking about, you know, the idea of the loose cannon cop versus the kind of character that Angel portrays, or Simon Pegg portrays as Angel. You know, we do have that. We do have that ideal in our movies too. The Captain America type cop, you know, the one who not to mention, and not to get personal, and I'm not going to go off on a tangent here, but it's something that gets brought up all the time in my professional life. You know, this idea of if you do a great job doing the same job, does a shitty job, instead of trying to lift the shitty person up or replace them because they can't function, do their work for them because they'll whine about it. But people who are out there in the office world know this whole concept of you having to make up for somebody else's shitty work. And it's funny because I was like, boy, howdy, have I had that experience in my professional career of,
yeah.
So much work or could you do Sally's work because she's terrible, but you know, it would be sad if we lost Sally. So could you help her out? And it's like, you know, as my father would say, no good deed goes unpunished. Again, these are all sort of familiar ideas to play around with for this. So in short, what we have here is your super cop from London who is shuffled off to the sleepy little village, making everyone look terrible. He's making they want to get rid of him. They send him there, and at first, you know, blend in, do his thing, and suddenly realizes, hey, wait a minute, as they should be, or as they would have you believe. Starts throwing the kids out of the bar that shouldn't be in there, and he's starting to notice. And eventually, he comes to the conclusion that some of these people are being murdered. And I loved the idea that any time that this has happened in the past, no one's questioned it. Because really, why? Who would murder in this town? You know, it's like I hear the South Park, bigger, longer, uncut in my head. This sleepy little podunk town, like murder. Crazy thoughts. Believable too, because it's like, because there are places like that where it's like nothing crazy ever happens here. So when you it's happening, it's the furthest thing. It defies logic. It goes against everything everyone believes because it's so far out there. That feeling of, you know, that Simon Pegg's character just sort of howling at the moon. That listen, all the evidence is there, and everyone having sort of, you know, denial of just like no, this can't possibly, you know, 2 + 2 can't possibly fuck. You know, you have after another, and you know, he's trying to get the other police that are not in on it to believe him, and they all think he's a douche nozzle too, and they won't cooperate. Thing after another, and finally things come to a head. And he realizes that it's not just one person, it's a group of people. And that brings us to the conclusion of the movie where, you know, they tell him this wasn't about land, it's about we'd be pretty, oh so pretty. And then we have the fucking gunfight in the street. Nick Frost, who, you know, he wants to be an action cop. And you know, and he makes for a good sidekick in this. He doesn't do much more than be a sidekick. But he has a fun speech at the end. Stay. it threw me. I forgot how the movie ended, and it really does like throw you for a loop when, you know, when you, they've taken out the town, they've processed everybody. There's that whole sequence where they're, you know, everybody's fingerprints and photo and everything. And they're all funning around at the end. You know, he's sort of very mundane. We have shit tons of paperwork to do. You never see that in any, like, other than The Wire. There's never any discussion of just how much needs to happen in your average arrest at work all the time. Somebody that gets brought in on like a simple trespass, deputy or the has to like sit at a desk and write a report, you know, that takes up like, and that's again for a simple trespass, you know, they'd be there for hours. So it what got me was that sort of surprise ending of the first examiner coming out with the gun, and then good old Chekhov's gun. They set this up earlier in the movie with the sea mine. Goes into the closet. The sea mine falls on him and blows the whole place up. It's like, wow, really? Like, did the movie really need that at the end? I guess so. I guess that's cool. And you get the false ending of you think the Nick Frost character is dead. Number one, he took a bullet in the chest. Number two, then they blew the place up. You know, they have the fake out ending. And then, of course, the London, he stays and they move on from there. So, you know, overall, one criticism of Hot Fuzz, and this might just be a subjective. I felt like none, except for maybe the woman who's just kind of, you know, there for laughs. But like the two detectives, I thought that they were too negative. Like there was nothing positive about them. And then when they turn and they join him and they have that whole showdown at the supermarket and everything, and they're on his side, it's like, yeah, but that doesn't make up for an entire movie where you're just lazy douche nozzles. And I don't know. I thought the characters were balanced. First of all, they were also like too samey. You know, we have two characters literally doing the exact same thing, and there's no conflict there. There's no change. Like maybe one character might have disagreed or felt differently about the situation, even when the revelations came out about what was happening in the town. But it was like we have two characters doing the exact same thing, and they're just through the entire movie. On his side, they're not much better. I thought that was maybe I'll give you a chance to respond to that. But that's really like my only criticism of the movie is that those characters bothered me, and I'm not entirely sure we needed to blow up the police station. But meh. Not gonna criticize it too much.
You know what? I don't mind they blew up the police station because even then, even that is sort of, you know, twisting the nose of the American conventions. It just isn't an action movie until a building blows the fuck up. You know, it doesn't matter if it's an airport, if it's Nakatomi Plaza, doesn't matter if it's the White House. Long as something goes kaboom, then you have truly punctuated your action movie. And as for redeeming the other characters, you know what? I don't think they really needed to be redeemed. And I even wonder if that was their intention, because sometimes lazy assholes are just lazy assholes, and there's even something kind of fitting about the notion of, okay, one noble act of valor in the nick of time does not make up for the fact you are a lazy asshole. That's, there's something kind of apropos about that. So I don't mind that. I didn't think they really needed to be redeemed. I think maybe they kind of needed to just sort of stand as they are, because there's something that's a little more a little more grounded about that. It's like a moment that my buddy Jeremy talks about one time back in the late 90s, when he and his best friend Steve, God rest his soul, were watching, I want to say it was WCW Thunder, and it was the episode when Hulk Hogan finally made the turnaround from going from being the black and white NWO heel to basically back to being the Hulkster. And he started out the show in the black and white, and there was the big pivotal moment where all of a sudden he basically cut a face promo and turned again. And at the end of the show, when he comes out for the main event tag match, he's wearing the red and yellow, and either Tony Schiavone or Mike Tenay are just having a good old double towel splooge in their pants, screaming, "Hulk Hogan is back! Hulkamania is back!" And Jeremy tells me that Steve just screamed at the TV, "All he did was change his underwear!" So I don't know. I think that would kind of about have been my reaction if they had tried to sincerely play it off like, "Oh, okay, now they're going to show up when they're needed. They're going to be the cavalry." That, and somebody said, "Oh, good, that totally makes up for what dickwad they were earlier. You guys are all right now." No. That doesn't make up for everything else. If Donald Trump springs for your Starbucks, that does not mean he never said grab her by the pussy. Fuck your Trump cup.
Yes. I don't disagree with you. Here would be my only counterpoint. While I would agree that realistically, no, you know, you don't get to make up for a world of shittiness in one act, mm-hmm. no matter how big the act is. However, we are talking about a dramatic presentation. A key element to these movies is finding that balance between relatability and realism with, entertainment and dramaticism. And I feel like my problem with the characters isn't so much in the believability as it was, I didn't find it entertaining after a while. And then it became too much of the same thing over and over and over again. And then when it changes, there wasn't a significant enough change to keep me engrossed in either of those characters. And before you say, yeah, but they weren't even the stars of the thing, they're still there. They play a major role. Of all the people that he has to deal with in that town, he deals with those two detectives, you know, as far as the secondary characters, the most. They're there in almost every scene that he's got to deal with these various murders happening. And I think, As I said, aesthetically, dramatically, it was too samey for me. That's what I'm getting at. It was like, well, what else are we going to do with these images on the screen to keep this interesting? But again, that might just be me. That said, same question I had for you with Shaun of the Dead. What other standout things were there for you in Hot Fuzz? And is there anything left about this movie that you want to talk about?
I think we nailed pretty much everything. I think it bears noting that God bless Edgar Wright for the fact that for every action movie clip you see playing in the background, he had to go around to the actors and stuntmen and get their permission for those clips to appear in the film. He had to pay rights to the studios for every DVD cover that popped up in the background. So, man, that's a lot of trouble to go to. And overall, I feel like we covered everything except for the fact that, goddamn, hats off to Jim Broadbent and Timothy Dalton for just being a couple scene-stealing motherfuckers as the bad guys in this movie. I love Jim Broadbent in almost anything he's in. He's one of those great that, unless you're a real movie nerd, one of those, that guy who was in That Thing, actors, Timothy Dalton, I don't think ever really gets the credit he deserves, despite the fact that, you know, obviously I loved him in stuff like Chuck, Doctor Who. He was a decent Bond, who just kind of had the misfortune to come along right when the series badly needed to take some time off and get a breath of fresh air. But he was really an, I think you want to say, a red herring bad guy, because he was kind of a perfect obvious guy to sort of head up the conspiracy of the NWA with the other townspeople. So, no, otherwise, I think it's a virtually perfect parody. It's a nearly perfect comedy, and I would agree that it's far and away, even if it's not the most personal exactly, the best movie of the trilogy, and that's only because, I gotta say, The World's End, for as well-intentioned as it was, it just feels awkward, out of place, and I'm not really sure this is how I would have wanted this trilogy to end.
Yeah, we need to talk about that. And let me right up front say, when I had forgotten what this movie was about, to be perfectly honest with you. And I knew I needed to watch it for this, and that was fine. I was okay with that. And like I said, having never seen it before, it was one of those ones that I eventually wanted to see. But I distinctly remembered I completely had forgotten what the twist was in this movie. What a twist! Regarding the aliens and the robots and whatnot. So when that reveal happens, I'm like, oh yeah. That. Now I remember why I didn't want to see this in the fucking first place, because I thought the premise was really stupid. Which, you know, that might be heresy to some people, but I'm entitled to my opinions, goddammit. And I really did think the idea of a pub crawl robot/alien invasion was like, I pass. This is not interesting to me. Now, I have been wrong before. They're just shocking, I know. But I have been resistant to some movies in the past and have found out that I was wrongfully resistant and ended up really liking them. The element of The World's End that I really liked had nothing to do with the stupid robots, and I actually felt it was kind of a distraction from what were some of the best parts of the movie, because some of the ideas in Shaun of the Dead, well, developed nicely and portrayed on screen very well, still took somewhat of a backseat to fucking zombies. And The World's End, the relationship stuff and the personal growth stuff in the movie is so strong, and something, I don't want to make it seem like like some of what they're struggling with were my own personal struggles, because that would be a lie. But I did get a sense of some of those struggles. You know, the idea of the boy, the Peter Pan, the boy that won't grow up, who is desperately clinging to the best years of his life and those memories, and has also become somewhat of a big shitbag. The guy who seemingly has everything, but really has nothing. That last little bit that the Nick Frost character, Andy, has. It's funny, it's the only character I remember whose name I remember. But, you know, the Andy character says something great at the end of that movie. You know, in the midst of all the stuff happening and all this chaos, he says, you know, they're arguing over that last pint of beer. And he's trying to stop him, and the Jack King, whatever the King character, the Simon Pegg says, "This is all I've got. You've got everything. I've got nothing. This is all I have." And he was just like, "It's not like that, though." It's something along the lines of, "You think I have everything, but I really don't. My wife left me, and she took the kids." And he's going into this whole thing. And again, I don't want to make it sound like, yeah, I totally get that, because I'm quite satisfied with my life, you know, with my wife and my kids and everything else. I wouldn't trade that for all the tea in China and all the gold in the world, to be perfectly honest. They are my reason for getting up in the morning. But I do have regrets, and I do on choices that I've made. Professionally, personally, outside of my wife and kids, I totally get of things are not always as you know, cracked up as you think they are. The grass isn't always greener on the other side of the fence. And I totally got character two, the idea of get it together after high school, and I made one bad choice after another, and it's just, you know, and I just want to go back to when I was happy and I had my whole life ahead of me. I was joking with a friend, and the same friend I brought up earlier, and I said there are days where I look and I go, I wish I could go back and make different decisions. I know exactly where things went wrong and how I ended up where I did, and I wish I could fix it. But I always come back to the same place, that if I ever got into a time machine, if the DeLorean ever shows up and I go back to 1994 and I make different decisions, I won't have the wife and kids that I have now, and that's not worth it. So that balance between being happy with the regrets from some of the terrible decisions that I've made, those were all elements of the movie that I was enraptured by. And I want, you know, because as I watch the movie, they get to this place in the movie where everyone recognizes that the King character is so terrible. And there's like no redeeming qualities about him. He's such a sociopath. Very early in the movie, to the point where I'm like, I think they were on like bar two when this happens. Pub two. Let's be British about it. And that's when he's confronted initially by Andy. And I was like, wow, they got there really quickly. Like, I don't know what's left. And I didn't remember the robots. So I'm like, what is left of this movie if they're already getting to this very confrontational point? And then shortly thereafter, he fights a robot in the bathroom. I'm like, ah, got it. Whoops, there's the rest of the movie. Okay, we're good now. But there was other things, too, which I didn't relate as closely with, but were interesting to me. The idea of love lost. You know, the character who plays the douchey detective from Hot Fuzz, he plays one of the buddies in this one, and his character is basically the one who's, you know, pining after Bilbo's sister. Yep, I'm just going to start calling these actors by their other character names. He's just pining after the one sister, and he's always been sort of cock-blocked by King. And it's like, this is it. This is, you know, my, you know, his life too, where on the one hand, good job. On the other hand, divorced. And he was like, you know, I missed an opportunity with this person because I kept shying away from King, who always sucked up all the light and energy in the room, all the air. And he takes this opportunity to fix it. And of course, he's taking this opportunity partially because the world is ending around him. So I thought all of that was interesting. And then you had something that I could very much relate to. You know, the one character who was bullied, and he says something so poignant in this movie about, it's not even the horrors that he bestowed upon me and how much he tortured the kid. It's that when he saw me, he didn't even recognize me, as if none of it ever mattered. And that's a very interesting and relatable idea. I mean, I know I got bullied. I was big enough that it never got physical because they'd gotten fucking killed if they had. But I couldn't do anything against any of the verbal abuse. I'm not that witty. You know, I'm not that quick. So I got a lot of verbal stuff. And that idea of that if I saw these people today, I don't think they'd recognize me either. Granted, I also didn't have a full beard at the time, so who knows? But, you know, just there was a lot of psychodynamic, emotional stuff happening in this. And then we got silly blue robot, you know, blue robots. And I'm calling it silly. And a lot of it was. But the very end of the movie, where they're talking to the network, really sums it all up very nicely. And I'm gonna say this, and then I'll throw it to you again. Because what's said and the whole theme of the thing was super relatable. This was my least favorite. Thematically, it was the most alluring, the most magnetic for me. This idea of freedom. I want to be free to make decisions, even bad ones. That living under the yoke of someone who's looking out for my best interest, possibly. But this, you know, he says the line, Peg does, I want to be free to get loaded and have fun. Something along those lines. And while, you know, getting loaded is not my dream come true, independence is. I, you know, take the word loaded out and sub in there this idea of I never want to have to deal with a boss again. And all that goes with it. I he said those things. I'm like, I am with you. I am absolutely with this idea. And the reverse of it too, you know, this idea of a benevolent dictator or benevolent God saying you are children, and in order to exist in this universe, you need guidance. I totally get that. As a parent, I totally get that. And so there's this really nice thematic conflict that's wrapped inside a really silly movie. And it makes it probably the most complex of the three as I'm talking about it. So I threw a lot out there, a lot of personal stuff, some film-oriented stuff. So might be a lot to digest. So kind of pick your pick the pork apart and tell me what you think.
And now it's my turn. Well, I'll say this. You're partially right about the themes, but I'll get to that in a moment. And, you know, I feel like it's fitting that we would be talking about this movie as the very last film we're going to talk about on a regular episode of Long Road to Ruin. And I feel that way for a number of reasons. You know, as I look back right now on the fact that almost exactly 4 years ago we co-founded this show in the fall, just because I wanted a chance to rant angrily on a bunch of sequels that I didn't like that didn't really necessarily fit with my original show that I had with Jeremy Lambert, it occurs to me that I approach this as very much the acerbic, wild-eyed rant machine who just loved to go off on profanity-laden tirades about movies that I didn't like, and every so often to get a chance to really praise and gush about the ones that I dug. I was a very different person then, as I've made no bones about. And it feels right that now in talking about this movie, instead of going off screaming and inventing wholly remarkable new uses for the F word, I'm instead, shall we say, having a bit of a final funeral for that character, for lack of a better word, and just once more stripping things away back to being my most earnest, personal, and honest, which is kind of who I plan to be going forward in all things. Not that I'm not going to be funny when the situation calls for it, but it's just that, well, as I've sometimes had to point out to some disappointed people over the years, especially the last two, I'm not that guy anymore. And, you know, I want to think for a second about the very end of this movie and think about the whole sum of what happens. And that is the fact that Gary, Simon Pegg's character, basically does everything that up to that point ever had been. All of the consequences that had led up to the world as we knew it, everything that kept everyone around us comfortable, and just because he decided he wanted to do things differently, that was all torn asunder. It was a matter of him deciding, hang on a sec, I'm sorry, my nose is still a little stuffed up. Because he decided that he wanted to change everything that he had ever known, what he got, I'm sure, wasn't exactly what he expected. He ended up completely talking the network out of everything they had built. The network summarily just gave up on their grand plan right when it was on the cusp of being fully realized. And as a result, they threw away about a century of communications advancement, and the world was plunged back into the Dark Ages. Oftentimes, over the last 2 years especially, I've had a lot of time to think, whether I wanted it or not, about a lot of mistakes that I've made, things I've said and done that have hurt a lot of people, things that hurt one person in particular. I've really been in Gary's shoes quite a bit. I've never let on about it on the air for damn easy to understand reasons, but folks, I had my share of nights between shows, times when maybe I was on hiatus, when I laid in my bed here in Phoenix and cried myself to sleep, actually praying that I wouldn't wake up because I lacked the conviction to kill myself. I'm not sure you really know rock bottom until you hit that point. It's a completely ineffectual, empty, lonely, powerless feeling. And it isn't something that I would wish on anyone. It's why I empathize with Gary so much. And it's why, quite honestly, I've never respected a movie so much without really enjoying it. It's because really the theme that Edgar Wright and Simon Pegg, right, by their own admission, set out to establish was not actually so much one of choice, but one of, well, in both a beautiful mix of a literal and figurative sense, alienation. In an interview, they said that they noticed that all the little towns in England where they grew up had been so overrun by franchises and big brand names and homogeneity that they were all unrecognizable. And it was an idea of going home and feeling like a complete stranger despite everything looking and feeling and seeming at first glance to be so familiar. It was being alienated from both, in a way, your present and your past. There's even a little bit of foreshadowing in the pub nicknames if you pay attention. The very first one they visit, the one where Gary first tries to really bluster himself up with confidence, is called The Famous Cock. That one in. And obviously, I don't think anybody really needs to have the symbolism of the world's end explained. It's a sci-fi homage to Invasion of the Body Snatchers, which is obvious to anyone who has ever seen that classic. And if you haven't, either track down the original, or I do believe there is also an excellent, I want to say, 1970s remake out there. I forget off the top of my head who was in it. Except that in this instance, we're not so much making it an allegory for the fear-mongering of socialism, or communism, rather, to be more specific. But it's more so just the idea of everyone and everything we love from the past being swept away and changed, not on the surface, but in such an intangible way that we can't miss it beneath, as to make it unrecognizable. It's hard to watch. It really, really is. Because before a lot of things happened and I was able to pull myself out of the dark place I had been and back to where I am right now, where I'm starting to pull my life back together, yeah, you know, there were times I could look at a lot of the little comforts that got me through the day and realize that while it might not have been a big deal to anybody else, some of this stuff was all that I had. It was all that distracted me. I was actually talking about this with a friend the other night. She was telling me about how much she had enjoyed playing the video game Life is Strange. And I had mentioned that despite the fact that I had already fully watched several times over a full Let's Play of it back about a year or so ago, that I still badly wanted to play it. And she kind of scoffed at the idea that I'd already watched the playthrough and told me that that was a bad idea, and I pretty much explained it as just that, as that I was going through a time when, you know, I didn't have much else to live for sometimes when my depression was at its worst, but I could at least watch the latest episode and it would go away just long enough to sort of get me back on track. And so I understand that gravitation toward the past that Gary feels. It's, how can I put this? It's both easy, it's easy to be seduced not only by that, but by the notion that you think you have it figured out how easy everybody else around you has it. As I've learned so many times lately, it's never, ever that simple. Even with we love the most. And yet, this is where I have to point out that I didn't enjoy it all that much, because try as it might, it was just so hard to watch the roles flipped on Simon Pegg and Nick Frost. Simon Pegg is an immensely talented performer with just absolute limitless range. I don't think we've probably seen the best performances he can deliver. Nick Frost, slightly less so. Still fun to watch, but he's obviously better when he's paired alongside Simon. Here we see him really playing against type. Nick is playing the fairly clean cut together straight man, obviously, or so it would seem. And meanwhile, Simon is playing a pretty goddamn deplorable human being. We don't want to root for him in this movie quite as much as we do in the other ones. In fact, he's the focal point, but it's everybody else that, if anything else, we feel sorry for. Sadly, it just lacks charm, but it's obvious that charm wasn't really what they were going for. They were trying to go for something deeply personal, resonant, something that everybody could feel and that might not necessarily, and that they might feel with a sensation that doesn't necessarily let go easily. But at the same time, did I enjoy it? Did I relish watching it as much as I did the first time that I watched Shaun of the Dead or Hot Fuzz? Sadly, no. I mean, it's a trilogy that I came to enjoy because it made me laugh. It made me light. And this, all of a sudden, had to go all maudlin and kind of hit me where it hurts. And when I wasn't really, when I didn't really see the punch coming. So my opinion would be, by all means, go out, give it a watch. Be ready, though, because if you thought that there were parts of Shaun of the Dead that touched you, this one's going to do that, too, except it's not going to be so much a touch as a little bit of a kick. Your mileage may vary. Give it a shot. Personally, I saw it. I think I could probably go the rest of my days without seeing again. But then again, you know, much like Gary, it's a reminder of how much it's time I moved on from.
I agree with a lot of what you said there, I certainly appreciate your candor in admitting some of the places you've been, so I thank you for that. Believe me, I've had my dark places too. I don't really like talking about it right now, but I have definitely been on my ass and on my face in the dirt, so I totally get that. I think where I agreed with you the most in terms of craft and how this film was put together was that it did lean too much on a lot of the themes, and while they are resonant, it's kind of like what I said about the detectives in Hot Fuzz, only amplified for an entire movie, which is to say, you know, as you were saying about Gary, it's like there's nothing. There's no arc here. I mean, he doesn't really change from one moment of the film to the next. There's a tacit recognition that he's not happy with himself. And I think the most gut-wrenching and honest moment is when he tells Andy, I tried to get help. And he was like, they told me when to go to sleep. Now, look, as somebody who's been dealing with the substance abuse world for most of his professional career, I would like to stress that one more time, professional career, not a drug user. I work with the drug users. Jesus. I want to make sure everyone understands that. But I do get that sense that, you know, the expectation in the substance abuse and rehabilitation world is that you are a fundamentally broken person and you need to give up a lot of your sense of self, a lot of your free will, in order to rid yourself of this monkey on your back. And if there's anything that I think contributes to the failure of people to get clean, it's that they don't want to do that. And this is not the time or the place to debate the merits of substance abuse treatment. But I will say, when he's talking about, they told me when to go to sleep, and you compare that with a few minutes later when he's telling the network, I want to be free. Therein, it's in the middle of those two statements that the whole movie really does rest. You know, that there is, that there are these forces that want you to conform and, you know, fit nicely in this hole. And there's this inherent resistance to fitting in that hole. Like I said before, that is something I very much identify with. And I struggle with to this day. This very work day, I was struggling with this concept of, I am asked and I am required and I am directly told, be this way. And there's an expectation that I will be this way. And every fiber of my being wants to resist it. And all I have to hang on to is, well, I don't want to lose my house. So I guess I'm going to have to. And the recognition that I've been down this road before. I'm 40 years old. This is not my first day of work. And I've had this happen again and again and again, and I've learned and I've matured and I've gotten better at handling it. But better doesn't mean it ever went away. I jokingly said to my wife, I said, I still have that punk rock ethos that I had in high school. It's just buried. It's buried under layers of alternating maturity and just defeat. So it's a real pretty picture I'm painting, but there it is. So I get where Gary is coming from. But the thing that I was getting at was, while that's great in a movie that is supposed to be a comedy, you know, about the end of the world and about robots and whatnot, I didn't laugh very much. And it was kind of like what you were saying. I'm like, it hit a little too hard for me to find any of it funny. And the stuff that was just supposed to be purely funny wasn't funny enough. You know what I mean? Like, it was on the one hand too emotional, and on the other hand, not witty enough. I just, like, it missed the mark on a lot of levels. It's not a poorly constructed film. It's just a combination of characters you don't want to root for, a lot of emotional, relatable stuff going on that makes it a little less fun to watch, and a general plot that I just found boring. Like I said, this had been strictly a character piece, and a study of one's own maturity and how they fit into this world, I guess it would have been fine. But to then jam robots into it and expect, hey, let's have a fun romp, I'm like, easy. You know, let's not throw Star Wars in the middle of fucking Schindler's List. It doesn't go together.
And, you know, speaking of the whole idea of maturity, let's not forget that in the end, the ultimate denouement for Gary is, yeah, he sobers up, but instead of reconnecting and making amends with his lifelong friends, he's instead palling around with the android versions of their younger selves. And it ends with them getting into a fight at a bar. You want to talk about...
We are no better off than we were.
No, the only way he's better off is in the fact that, well, number one, judging from Andy's general demeanor, he doesn't seem to bear Gary any ill will. But he's more stuck in the past than he's ever been. The only difference is, you know, thank heaven for small favors, he's at least sober. I mean, he's at least ordering water instead of pints of lager. So, yay! I never thought that I would be kind of just wanting to golf clap for a character's sobriety. But in this
well,
case,
I think
it's about my
it would be remiss
reaction.
If we did not. Right. I think we would be remiss if we did not at least recognize this much. The one thing that Gary has, you know, as far as a win, as far as an arc or anything else, is that he is free at the end of the movie. It's at the cost of civilization itself, but he's at least free. So, man, yeah. Well, what are you saying there, Mr. Wright? I want to end this podcast discussion of these three movies by talking about a different movie, a movie under the column, under the heading of what might have been, which is always one of my favorite parts of the show. It's usually something you bring up. When we talk about production notes and stuff in the what might have been column. But I could not, at the end watching these three movies, I could not help but think of what might have been if Marvel hadn't come up with the concept of the cinematic universe and therefore jammed their ideas into Edgar Wright's vision of an Ant-Man movie. If we had gotten a pure, unadulterated Edgar Wright Ant-Man without Marvel's blessed interference, what they might have come up with. And, look, I am a Marvel flag bearer, if there ever was one. I have very little in the negative to say about it other than their villains are worth a shit. But and if you'd like to hear more about that, go listen to our podcast. Rob Winfrey and I, we rail against Marvel villains in the archives. But there is a small part of me that does wish that Marvel took a step back and let some of these directors really play in the sandbox and not be so tied to the scripture that is the cinematic universe. And to draw this back to center, I know you're dying to tell me something here, so I'm going to let you do it. But I wish I had gotten to see what the vision for Ant-Man was, because I think it would have been Marvel.
Ooh.
Go ahead.
Oh, well, I got a little more now that you've kind of expanded on that a little bit. But I was going to say, in terms of the idea of Edgar Wright directing Ant-Man, let me just say this. I mean, in particular, the very first thing that pops to my mind, if you don't watch that scene of Emilio recounting how he heard about the big score at Hank Pym's place, and you don't think of the, we go to the Winchester, grab a pint, wait until this whole thing blows over, little set of montages from Shaun of the Dead, then that right there is my first giveaway that you've never seen Shaun of the Dead. It was the first thing that popped into my mind. But
sure.
No, I completely agree that at one point Marvel went from starting out letting its directors very much have free reign, do things their way, to Age of Ultron, to be honest with you, is where it really hit critical mass with a lot of things. I can't tell if it's Kevin
Kevin Fugazi.
Or
no, we're gonna go with Kevin Fugazi.
Yeah, Kevin Fettuccini. That's what I said. And
okay.
or if it was Disney who was really influencing the direction. But in talking with my good friend Kara from FPG News, really, I have to wonder if some of these directors, if they had maybe had a little more control in particular, wouldn't have maybe spoken up about a few more things that ended up being really problematic, especially a lot of character issues that are dealt with. I've often wondered, was it Joss Whedon or was it Disney who really kind of influenced Black Widow proclaiming herself a monster because she was barren? Or basically just kind of brushing Tony Stark's PTSD right off the table, ignoring Clint Barton's history of familial abuse and his deafness, things like that. I don't know. There were times when, to kind of take things back to Ant-Man a little bit before I get too far off track, there were times where, yeah, it really did still feel a little bit like an Edgar Wright movie, but they're really few and far between. And I've never really gone and looked at whether Edgar or anybody else has acknowledged, okay, this was what happened that really put me off the project entirely. Did you ever read anything? Ever hear anything?
I mean, I know that in all truthfulness, Winfrey and I actually discussed it without knowing any other of the details, and we did know some. It did look like a mashup. It was kind of like a non-incompetent version of Fanforstic, you know, which. Which felt like two different movies jammed together and thrown out there. Ant-Man absolutely felt like half an Edgar Wright movie and half, you know, Marvel Cinematic Universe movie. You could feel where the influence of Edgar Wright was taken out and the Marvelness was put in, and vice versa. You could definitely feel like you were watching an Edgar Wright movie in certain areas. So it was an interesting when Robert and I reviewed the movie last year, you know, one of the things we said is like it was a very weird film experience because you got this feeling like it was a very confused movie. Not that the plot was confusing in any way, pretty simple, but it thematically, craft wise, everything felt very jumbled. So they absolutely, I know for a fact, they kept elements of his vision, but they had to jam in Falcon, and there was just a lot of stuff that was kind of, they threw a lot of ingredients into the gumbo and then was like, okay, well, it's not your original recipe in any way, shape, or form, but it's got your essence in it. Your essence is in the gumbo.
Yeah, now that you mention it, as much as I enjoyed that sequence with Falcon, I can't deny it. It felt forced. It felt like we have to, by hook or by crook, get something right in the movie that connects this directly to everything else that's going on in the MCU. Like, you know, the mid and post credit sequence definitely was not going to be enough. And maybe that's why it was in there. Maybe they needed something so that Falcon later, when he's convening with Steve Rogers, get out of that line. Yeah, I might know a guy.
Right.
It did kind of set that up.
Marvel is nothing. I was going to say, Marvel is nothing without its connective tissue, but it was...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and they do that really well, but it's also, it's very easy for that to feel forced. I think that early on, when you look at, basically the movies that led up to the first Avengers, it felt much more subtle, a little more smooth and judicious with how they worked it in there.
Right.
Whereas everything else, it feels like way too convenient a name drop. That's just made to pop the nerd boner. You know, in Winter Soldier, as long as we're rattling off everybody that Hydra's going to be keeping track of, oh, what the hell, let's throw Stephen Strange in there. just fucking forgetting the entire fact. You don't mind when it's less.
I was going to say, I didn't mind the subtle ones. When they got to Age of Ultron and it turned into Daffy Duck's Scarlet Pumpernickel script, where it was like by the end of it, and then the dam broke. I was like, oh, come on. Like, do we need all these references? Do we need all this shit jammed into this movie? Poor Josh Whedon. it broke Josh Whedon, goddammit. And Age of Ultron broke that poor man. It was like, listen, we'd like you to take 10 pounds of shit and shove it into this 1-pound bag. What do you think about that, Josh? And he went, Mama!
Well, and then there are those times when the references really don't pan out to anything. Like how they, my favorite one
right.
is wedging a Howard the Duck cameo into Guardians of the Galaxy. And then promptly telling the world, just so we're clear, no, we have absolutely no intentions of making a Howard the Duck movie. It would be like, well, since I haven't seen it yet, since I'm going to see it probably on Christmas Day, since I have nothing else going on, it would be like if, for fuck knows what reason, Doreen Green, the unbeatable Squirrel Girl, were to show up at the end in an end credit sequence in there, and then in Kevin Feet Fetish were to pop up in an interview and say, what? Marvel, you know, no, we just put her in there as a lark. We don't even own the rights to her character. God, no, we're not making a Squirrel Girl movie. God damn you. Wow, we somehow ended up talking
about
Marvel movies.
With all that being said, yeah, there's a shock. Mr. Wright, we've talked about everything. We've talked about everything but him. He has a very distinctive style. I think in a row it gets a little can be a little repetitive. These sort of close up cuts that he does, but it's a very distinctive style. In as far as being a competent craftsman, he's probably one of the best. He's very quirky. He's made, even with all the positive and negative things we've said about these three movies, they're some of the most interesting I've seen in quite some time. And I know that there's other people out there going, but what, Paul Thomas Anderson and this person and that person. Okay, let me be specific. These are the most interesting movies that didn't bore the fuck out of me. So, you may feel different.
As long as we're talking about directors with the last name Anderson, yes, he's quirky. He has a very distinctive style. But the thought that immediately popped into my head was, you know, unlike that pretentious douche Wes Anderson, who I think has made let's see, I almost said one, but then I couldn't remember if he made Election, which I really liked. I don't think he did. So I'm going to say, yeah, Rushmore. So one movie that I actually genuinely really found interesting. That's it. And otherwise, every other time I've watched Steve's The Life Aquatic or The Royal Tenenbaums, it hasn't been overtly bad, but I just wanted to turn to kind of every hipster skinny jeans wearing friend of mine and tell them to put the fucking Pabst Blue Ribbon down and stop eating their pesto linguine out of a mason jar and tell me what the hell is so great about this guy. Because I just don't get it. Whereas on the other
hand,
when it comes to Edgar Wright movies, we've just spent, you know, the better part of 2 hours talking about so many things that could translate across, especially all three of these movies, that you can point to and go, okay, this is exactly why I like him. It's the same reason I can point to Kevin Smith and Robert Rodriguez and more than just, oh, this movie is starring so-and-so. Oh, it's directed by so-and-so. Fucking ticket. Now, take my money. I will shoot it at you with a pneumatic cannon if I have to. Just give me my ticket, give me my popcorn, and leave me the hell alone for 2 hours.
Take my money, please. All right, I think that that wraps it up for this edition of Long Road to Ruin in our Three Flavors Cornetto Trilogy review. I want to just a quick sort of statement about the show in general. I came to Shaun a couple of years ago because I have a great love for talking about movies. I also have a great love for talking about music. These are two things I've done for the better part of my life. This is how I related to people. I spent hours at a party once debating the merits of old Metallica versus new Metallica. I've spent countless hours discussing the merits of this movie versus that movie, this comic book character versus that one. These are things I'm passionate about. I've always been passionate about movies. I've always been passionate about music. And if it weren't for those two elements of life, I don't know how I would have gotten through some of the periods where I was not doing well. Music and movies always carried me through, and finding people to talk about them with has always been a great joy of mine. And it's been fun. We've had some interesting shows. We've definitely had some interesting discussions.
Mm-hmm.
I've met some really great people over the course of this time. And so I want to thank them. First and foremost, I have to thank Shaun for agreeing to do this with me. He didn't have to. He really didn't know me from a hole in the wall. We've never actually physically met in person. We met through another mutual virtual body, Mr. Jeremy Lambert. So, to Jeremy Lambert, thank you for introducing me to Shaun.
Amen.
And to you, Shaun, thank you for being a part of this. I also have to thank Robert Winfrey, who, you know, as far as super fans go, he has his own show on here. Yes, we do a show together. But if there's anybody that I'm aware of who's listened to more Long Road to Ruin than not directly involved with it, it was probably him. He, for the longest time, would listen live and send us notes and, you know, communicate through Facebook and everything. And in times where I had to take a hiatus to father a child or just take a break for any number of personal reasons, Robert was there to fill in. I have to thank my Damn You Hollywood host, Mr. Robert Winfrey, for really being as much a part of this show as either myself or Shaun. He's a good friend, and he's greatly appreciated. I want to thank some of the Jesse Starcher, who I didn't even realize was a fan of this show for the longest time. He's our third chair now in the Metal Hammer of Doom. He's a really good guy. He's a great host of his own show, Source Material. And he's another one who used to listen in and send us notes, and was always very enthusiastic about this. So I appreciate Jesse. I appreciate everything he's done for this network, for myself, for the show. And I, you know, I don't know what I'd do without him. I have one less person putting up stuff on Blog Talk Radio for me when I'm too busy. I guess that's what I'd have to figure out. Speaking of super fans, Andrew Graham, my good buddy there from Canada, another fan of the show, another fan of the network. someone who I've become friends with on Facebook. Just one of these guys who, you know, who's always given us feedback and has been, we've had him on a couple of shows here. He was great to have on. He had some great insight during the Bourne trilogy and some of the other shows. And again, very much appreciate the time and energy he put into this. Again, this is not a paid gig. Nobody has to do this, but people volunteered, people showed up, you know, and participated when I needed them to. If I'm leaving people out, I apologize. But your friend Jason, he was on our show with the Alien Predator. Sure. I had him on for Star Trek. Mm-hmm. He was great. So thank you to him for being a part of the show. Gavin, Chris from the Casual Heroes, they've been on some select shows here and there. I appreciate them. Pat was on a couple of shows. Mr. Pat Mullen, formerly of the Ground and Pound show. Again, we still talk pretty much daily in our Facebook chat. Always appreciated his help with some of these shows. My wife, I thank her for two reasons. One, for putting up with this. This is, you know, I'm in my living room in between my kids' room and our bedroom, and she has to put up with me once a week yelling and screaming into the computer for one reason or another, which she didn't have to. But she also has been on a couple of our shows. She was on the Twilight one. She was great. Mm-hmm. She's a great, great, tolerant woman who has banned Weird Al Christmas songs from the house.
Aww.
Which I find very amusing. Anyway,
crazy.
Yeah, I know. Tell me about it. Yes, inappropriate is what she tells me. Anyway, so thank you, Melissa. Love you. You're currently sleeping. You're not hearing this. And that's really. I'm going to throw it to Shaun for his final word. I'm going to let him have the last word here, other than. But as I said, we had a lot of people involved with the show. By the way, and thank you, Alexis, also. Alexis, assist.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
A Harry Potter show. I just want to say again, doing these podcasts, this is my outlet. This, you know, I don't get to do this stuff very often. My friends are all in New York and I don't get to talk to them very much anymore. Life gets in the way. And so my outlet to just sort of turn my brain off and think about some other stuff besides my daily life stressors. This is a time out for me. This is fun. This is my time at the gym. This is roller coasters. I can have a genuinely positive debate or discussion about movies is great fun. And it's been great fun doing Long Road to Ruin. And it's been great fun with Mr. Comer. So, again, thank you to everybody who bothered to listen to this. Thank you, Larry Zonka. Larry Zonka from 401 Mania, who, big fan of this show, you know, posts this stuff on Twitter, reminds everyone to tune in to listen. He's been listening while he's out there playing video games in his house somewhere. Thank you to him. Again, nobody has to do any of this stuff, but you did, and I appreciate you. Any last words?
You know, thank you for letting me kind of have some time to say some thanks of my own. First of all, I apologize for any redundancy, but I also owe a lot of gratitude to a lot of the same people. And also, if you're out there listening, please do not take your place in the order of this list as any kind of slight whatsoever. I'm just kind of going with these as I think of them. But first and foremost, I've collaborated creatively with a lot of people over the years, and unfortunately, not all of them have necessarily become more than collaborators. Meeting Mark, just because I had an idea that for a show that wouldn't necessarily fit on what was then Bad Movie Review Club, it gained me not only one of my favorite people to work with, but somebody that I consider and would, even if we were to never do a podcast together again, a true, absolute, genuine friend that I would want with me to the end of the earth. Mark Radulich, thank you so very much from the deepest bottom of my heart for all the great times we've had making this show, making other shows, and for all the times that you have been a supportive rock to me when I was at my lowest, and reminding me that when I got my head straight and the fog had kind of cleared, that I would still have a place I could come back to. That meant more to me than I was ever able to express. And obviously, I look forward to you and I podcasting for a long time to come. We are not done by a damn sight, man. This has shown me that I have a passion for this that I never knew ran so deep. And it has also given me a tremendous, tremendous, it's been an outlet. It's been a motivator. It has been an anchor. It's been a constant. And I want it to stay that way for hopefully years to come, regardless of what else it is that we end up doing. From there, I remember back when Robert Winfrey and I were doing our Hellraiser two-parter, one of my very favorite editions of the show that we ever put together. And at some point during the show, I believe it was either during Hellraiser, I happened to mention that we were looking to spice up our promotion, and we were hoping to find somebody out there who might know a title card artist who would work for fairly cheap. As it turns out, we had a regular listener whose idea of cheap was, hell man, I'll do it for nothing. And Benjamin J.
Oh,
Cologne,
my God, I'm so sorry. I forgot.
It's okay, man.
Oops.
Continue,
but I'm so sorry.
Ben became so much more than a title card artist to myself and to Mark. He became, well, like so many other people, a true beloved friend, not just of the show, but of the two of us, and has been ever since. We've gone from just talking about movies to we have talked music, wrestling, MMA, oh God, comics so damn many times. I remember Ben watching the Crow sequels with me via chat. We were getting ready for that show, and him even putting together a nice little Photoshop when I made a crack about how I want to say it was Edward Furlong in the makeup looked like Zooey Deschanel had gone hog wild with a Hot Topic gift certificate, and the son of a bitch actually photoshopped it. Ben, love you, man. You are welcome to be on any show we are on anytime. We will find something for you to do. Just what more can I say, man? One of the finest human beings I've ever met. I would certainly echo the feelings about Robert Winfrey. Robert and I struck up a conversation during a show. It was during the Paranormal Activity podcast. I could tell from the way he referenced the movies to me, he referenced the movies and the Saw movies, and I'm rambling a little bit. And made a very apt Terminator comparison to explain Toby in the Paranormal Activity movies. And from then on, I just went, this man shall be my friend. And good old Sam the Eagle, we have had some weird conversations that you guys will never know about. Everything seems to always evolve into Invader Zim jokes between us, to my great, great pride. But Robert is a gentleman and a scholar and somebody else that I would never have met had I not had the opportunity to do this show. And the same goes for you too, Robert Cooper. I haven't forgotten you, man. You are a weird guy sometimes, but you are quirky, warm, friendly. You always have a kind word. I appreciate the times you allowed me on Metal Hammer of Doom to kind of let my musical Jones out a little bit. Just truly an incredible guy, and I have got to get back on your show sometime in the near future. Speaking of Metal Hammer, Jesse Starcher, my God, man. You came on as kind of a new addition to Radulich and Broadcasting, and I'll be damned, man. I'm going to come right out and say it. Your show, a lot of times, pretty much surpassed ours. You became an absolute superstar who's a joy to listen to every single week. I love source material. I regret that I haven't been on it more often. That's got to change. We got to do something about that. There's so many books that we haven't talked about. Kind of along those lines too, you know what? I'm putting aside their probably very understandable feelings about me and mine toward them. Hats off and a cup raised to Jason Teasley, Pat Mullen, and Gavin Napier. You have all definitely stepped up and contributed mightily to a lot of great creative moments. I had to step away for a while for the sake of my own sanity. I appreciate what you did to keep the show going, and I wish all three of you the best of luck in whatever it is you might be doing. Andrew Graham, one of the absolute smartest guys I have ever known, a great Canadian, great man, great hockey fan. Damn you for liking the Sharks, but you know, nobody's perfect. And the joy to talk martial arts with, mixed martial arts, movies, absolutely anything. You know, proud son of one of the greatest countries in the world, in my opinion, and someone else that I would have never met had it not been for this show. And James Rocco, same goes for you, man. I love it when you just kind of randomly ping me on Facebook just because you want to talk, because it's usually when I kind of need a breather anyway. devotion like that, you just can't help but appreciate it, because you don't have to listen, but you do. You make sure you tune in, and I hope to God you'll still tune in just as much to On Trial and share your opinions with me there. That being said, Alexis, someone who knows me about as well after 16 years as just about anybody possibly can, thank you for being on the show. Thank you for being such a wonderful friend. Thank you for being so supportive. She has helped me out with trivia and bouncing ideas and thoughts and jokes off her so many times, just calling her at random throughout the day, which makes sense because she is technically kind of my boss. Another one who is just welcome to collaborate anytime we have something that, you know, perks your ears up. Jeremy and Ann, my two longtime friends and hopefully future podcast hosts, two more people I could say the same thing about, always supported me, tuned into the show, gave me their feedback. Couldn't ask for two people to help keep me sane. And I think last but not least among the really personal ones, and it's hard to when it comes to this one, but I'm going to try not to get too personal. Scarlett, you have been bringing out the best in me for 6 years, and it's a best version of myself that when we met, I would have sworn was gone. It was buried, lifeless. My best, most earnest, funniest moments on this show are you kind of coming to the surface. in a way. And you've always been honest with your feedback, and you know, whether it's been criticism or encouragement. And more importantly than any time I spend speaking to an audience, you've meant the world to me in the terms of being my anchor, being my compass, being my northern star. People like you come along once every few lifetimes, and that's if this world is lucky. And nothing I ever say in this lifetime or probably the next will ever do justice to just how highly I think of you and how much of my continued creative passion and my will to be better I owe to you. And I mean every last breath of that. And last, but damn, absolutely sure not least, thank you to every single last one of you, everyone who listens live, everyone who downloads, everyone who passes the link on to a friend, everyone who bothers to pass along their feedback, everyone who's offered us movie suggestions. You know, obviously we love what we do, but we do it because we believe there are people who want to hear us. Without you, there is no us. There is no this. So thank you for the part that you play in that. This is not the end. Obviously, On Trial is coming next year. Nick and I both feel as refreshed and ready and pumped for this as we ever have. So, for the last time under the Long Road to Ruin banner, I'm Shaun. You're not. $20 will buy many peanuts. And just as surely as it is etched across my shoulders in black ink, never dull your colors for someone else's canvas.
All right, folks, it's been real. It's been a show. This is it. We are done with Long Road to Ruin for the foreseeable future. As Shaun said, Will and I said at the beginning of the show, we got a new jam called On Trial. It's going to be me and Shaun defending and prosecuting a single movie. And partially because I wanted to change formats, and partially because trying to sit down and jam an entire franchise into a very small viewing period became untenable. So just because I like to read schedules, real quick. Yeah, right over there. just some of the stuff that I got planned. I got some of the stuff I got planned for next year. As Shaun said, we're going to be doing Big Trouble in Little China to start off with, Inception in January. February, we got Resident Evil. And again, this is partially why I wanted to do this. We're going to do Halle Berry's Catwoman in February. In March, X-Men Origins. In March, one of the ones I picked out was X-Men Origins Wolverine. We're trying to do that around the same time that Logan comes out. Yes, because I'm not moving in any way away from Synergy. Not happening. In May, I thought it would be fun with the new King Arthur movie coming out. We would look at the 2004 masterpiece, King Arthur. With the dude that played Mr. Fantastic. I remember seeing that one in the theaters. I thought that would be a fun one to have a debate over. June, when Wonder Woman comes out, On Trial, Superman Returns, which is one that I refused to talk about when we did the Superman Long Road to Ruin. And so, you know, we'll have a chance to get to the one we never got to, Superman Returns. still going to do the Amazing Spider-Man in July. Amazing Spider-Man 2. I'm going to absolutely let Shaun pick one for the month of July, but I picked an extra one just because we got to do it. Tim Burton's Planet of the Apes.
Oh, God.
Yeah, these are some challenging ones, I'll tell you. And I know that I'm probably going to do either... I know in October, when the new Friday the 13th prequel comes out, probably do the last Friday the 13th or Blade Runner. I haven't decided yet. But we are definitely doing Halloween 3. Shaun made it a point to want to do this.
Wait. Your Honor, point of order. When you say the last Friday the 13th, are you talking about the last reboot? Or are you talking about Jason Goes to Hell?
The last reboot.
Oh, okay. Yeah, and actually, I would have been wrong anyway because I forgot that after Jason Goes to Hell, but before Freddy vs. Jason, there was Jason X. So, but yeah, okay,
yeah. If Jason X is the one where he goes to space, I've been debating that one as well. So, yep, Shaun made a mention of it. We will definitely be doing Halloween 3: Season of the Witch. I got nothing. No, I got no ideas for November. And then in December, for sure, before the end of the year, we will be doing On Trial, Jumanji, with Robin Williams. So those are just some of the, because there's Jumanji coming out with The Rock. Again, synergy. So appetizer for you. Some stuff I got planned. I got, you know, I got to get together with Shaun and get more of his picks penciled in for the calendar, but I figured, you know, maybe I'd let 2016 finish before I start pressuring him to come up with ideas. But those are some of the ones that I'd want to do. I'm looking forward to it. This is one fun list. So with that said, because God, what's a show? What's a long road to ruin without an hour's worth of plugs? To Ben and Cooper and anyone who I didn't mention the first time. Ben, I still have your stuff hanging on my wall. You know I love you, even if I forget to mention you the first time. So with that,
we all love Ben.
This is it. Yes, I've got nothing more to say. We'll see you next week for our reviews of Rogue One. Shaun will be back for the review of Assassin's Creed. Tomorrow's Metal Hammer of Doom is our last official album review. We've got a Christmas show and then our year-end review, and then we're done with that for the year. So with that, thank you all once again. If you've stuck with this show this long, I appreciate you listening to all of our thank yous and plugs. Be well, be safe, and behave.